Please welcome one of the foremost freedom fighters on the scene today. Nonie Darwish is the author of three books, Now They Call Me Infidel, about her own life journey, Cruel Unusual Punishment, which is about Islamic law, and now The Devil We Don't Know, about the reality behind the so-called democracy movements of the so-called Arab Spring. Please welcome Nonie Darwish.
Thank you very much for being here and staying to hear us. I want to thank Alvaro and the students for intellectual freedom. Thank you for believing in us and inviting us. I also want to thank Pamela Geller and Robert Spencer. These are ordinary American people who believe in us, who believe in Simon and me, who believe in our cause. Why did we come to America? Why did we leave our culture of origin? I was born and raised as a Muslim in Cairo, Egypt, and in the Gaza Strip, where under Islamic law, criticizing the religion of Islam, criticizing Muhammad, is punishable by death, even if you repent. Islam is the only religion on earth that punishes those who leave it by death. In America, I am grateful that the penalty for criticizing Islam today on college campuses is only shaming, smearing my reputation, and name-calling us. I never thought I will see the day where the Hamas defenders, where the defenders of the Muslim Brotherhood will get more respect in the United States college campuses than former Muslims who are, and former slaves of the Islamic world, who are under a death fatwa right here in the land of the free and the home of the brave. Under Islamic law, the penalty, for leaving Islam, I have a fatwa of death on my head. The tricky part is a lot of Muslims will tell you, but how many people are really actually being killed by governments for leaving Islam? Yes, it's not that much. But the tricky part in Islamic law, which is called Sharia, that I studied for a couple of years before writing my book, they delegate the execution of apostates not only to the police and the government to arrest you, execute you, like what's happening today to a man in Iran today. But the tricky part is a law that states that any Muslim on the street can kill us and they will never be punished. That's a law. What is a law? Why am I afraid of a law? Because when I criticize a law, this is the bottom line of every society. The bottom line of every society, its value system, is controlled by the law. So you can be against executing apostates as much as you want as a Muslim. But it doesn't matter if the law will execute me. It doesn't matter if the law will tell Muslims on the street that if they kill me, they will get away with it and they'll be heroes under Allah. So don't tell me I'm against killing apostates, and I'm a moderate Muslim. Who cares? Under the law, I have a fatwa of death against me today. And I care, I'm afraid. The law clearly states that the killer of those apostates will not be punished. And nobody is in jail for killing apostates in the Muslim world, for honor killing of girls. Nobody's in jail for killing Christians in Egypt. Nobody is in jail for killing Jews. They are supposed to be heroes and doing Allah's work. And I'm supposed to be silent, because if I say that, I'm an Islamophobe. I was born and raised as a Muslim in Cairo, Egypt, as I said, and in the Gaza Strip, where I learned hatred, vengeance, and retaliation. Jihad, which is defined, this is the definition of jihad, ladies and gentlemen. It's not an inner struggle, and it's not self-analysis, as they claim it is. in the books of Sharia, it's defined as warring with non-Muslims to establish the religion. And in Al-Azhar University, which is in Cairo, where I was born and raised, it is taught as a permanent war institution against Jews, Christian, and pagan. Permanent war institution. Why do we have a Middle East crisis? Just remember the link. I witnessed honor killing of girls. I knew girls who were honor killed. They were my friends. And let me tell you, when one girl is killed in honor killing, it sends a message to all of us. And we are living in fear as women. I don't have to be killed in honor killing to get the message. There are 5,000 honor killings in the Muslim world every year. Enough to put us on warning. You violate what the Sharia tells you to do, and this is what's going to happen to you. So we get the message we live in fear. When a man looks at us, we self-doubt, what did I do to make him interested in me? Because in Islamic law, we are tempting men. And that's why it's our responsibility. If a man is interested in us, and if we get raped, we better not tell anybody. Because if we get raped, it's our responsibility. The girl I knew as a friend was raped, and she was actually killed by her father. Nobody goes to jail in the Middle East, across the Middle East, for killing these girls. And you know why? There are actual laws to protect them. The killers of honor killing victims. Here are the laws, and if you don't believe me, the killer of an adulterer will not be punished, will not be punished. This is a law in Sharia. So it doesn't matter how many Muslims disagree with these laws. This is the law of the book in Egypt and in over 50 Muslim countries. This is the book, this is the law in the book. Half the population could disagree with it, but they're not doing anything. And when a girl is honor killed, nobody defends her. I lived in the Middle East for 30 years, and I never heard a sermon by a Muslim sheikh defending the victims of honor killing and making honor killing an anti-Islamic act. I never heard a Muslim sheikh stand up for this little girl who was killed in an honor killing. Actually, they stand up in the pulpit of mosques and tell men how to beat their wives. They never say honor killing is anti-Islamic. This is just a propaganda thing in America to make Americans, you know, just don't be afraid of Islam. It's we who are anti, you know, Islamophobes and bad people, because we're trying to insult a religion. Since when does America make insulting a religion a crime? Am I in the Middle East again? What has happened to America? I am ashamed. So I witnessed female genital mutilation, which is also the law in the Shafi'i sect of Sharia. 97% of my mother's generation had this surgery, including my own mother, who lived all her life scared from this, what happened to her when she was 7 years old. Why am I supposed not to say that in America? Wake up, you educated people. Listen to me. Am I supposed to be afraid to insult an ideology or a religion? Is that the shame that I'm supposed to have? I'm supposed to be ashamed? I'm supposed to be called a bigot and a hate monger? Because I'm criticizing an ideology. I'm not criticizing Muslim people. For God's sake, my whole family in Egypt is Muslim, and they don't talk to me anymore because I left Islam. And they are some of the nicest people you'll ever meet. I'm not talking about people. I'm talking about an ideology and a legal system that is a dark age legal system that has a sword on my neck. And you're telling me not to talk. Shame on anyone who tells me not to talk. I lived in a gender segregated society where I dealt only with women. I could not deal with men. I lived in total isolation from men. If they are seen with a non-relative in Saudi Arabia today, if you're seen in a coffee shop with a male who's not a blood relative, you get arrested and you get flogged. What kind of society is this? What are you defending, sir, ladies and gentlemen? What are you defending? Put aside that women can't drive. A woman in a coffee shop with a co-worker, because this is a true story, the lights were off in her job, and she was seen in the coffee shop with her co-worker, who's not a blood relative. And guess what? She was humiliated. She had blue marks all over her back from being flogged. This is the ideology that you're defending, and you're trying to shame me from standing up against. No. A lot of people say this is a cultural thing. You know, oppression of women in the Muslim world is a cultural thing. Well, Islam really honored women. This is ridiculous. There was a sheikh the other day, a Muslim sheikh, who was saying that we don't allow slapping women on the face, only their body, because we honor women. Oh, we honor women. We don't like to beat them on the face. We only beat them with a stick on the body. Thank you for this kind of honoring. And I'm not supposed to speak. How can I dare speak about that? Here we are. There are laws of Sharia that are horrible. I mean, even though I was from an educated class, an upper class in Egypt, my father was the head of the Egyptian military intelligence, and I wasn't even in the classes where women are really mistreated. And I was standing in front of my school one day, waiting for my mom to pick me up, and there was a boy my age who was standing about three meters away from me, and he started talking to me as my mom came to pick me up. I don't have to be killed. There is horrific things that happen. As a 16-year-old, my mom picked me up. She beat me when I went home for doing, and she put me in practically under house arrest for 2 weeks because a boy was standing just directing his face at me. And I kept telling her, I didn't tell him anything. Mom, I didn't do anything. He was standing there talking to me. I didn't talk to him. I kept begging her, but she was a victim herself. Because she told me, what are you doing? Our reputation, your reputation will be, you'll disgrace the family. This is the atmosphere I grew up with, ladies and gentlemen. After I came to America, it took me a year to feel normal. And I now feel sorry for my sisters in the middle Muslim world who live in isolation under this burqa. Many of them are forced to wear it. My own cousins call me and tell me, we're forced to wear it. We have to wear it. Because in the street, if you choose not to wear it, some of them, they throw acid on them. Okay? I don't care about people who do it if that's what they want. Gender segregation and discrimination came to Egypt, ladies and gentlemen, in the 7th century, when Islam conquered Egypt. But Egypt, before Islam conquered it, had women as rulers. Women were honored. Hatshepsut, Queen Hatshepsut, built navies, and she ruled with an iron fist. She was feared by men, and she was respected. We had Queen Tea, we had Cleopatra, we had Nefertiti. After Islam came, never in a million years would these queens of Egypt have ever imagined that invasion of a, that they would be invaded by a dark ideology that would prohibit them from having been queens in Egypt. That should be a warning to America civilizations, because civilization can be taken over from within. And yes, it's the passage of time is not necessarily positive progress. Egypt has a 5,000-year history, and the passage of time on Egyptian history was not very positive. It took it back to the Dark Ages. There are so many legal discrimination against women, I don't have time to list it, but it's there. There is discrimination, legal discrimination against non-Muslims in Egypt. The Christians, they are burning the churches. No one of the Muslims here. Where are you to go riot and stand and say to people that stand in front of the Egyptian embassy and say, no more burning of the churches in the name of Islam. No more burning of churches. Where is the news in America about the head, the head of the former dean of Islamic law? This is like the Pope, the position of the Pope in Saudi Arabia. He just recently, very recently, made a statement that the purchase and sale of slaves is legal under Islam. That's his statement. Quote, Allah permitted the purchase and sale of slaves. Slaves are the property of their owner. This is slavery in the Sharia. Yet a slave enjoys a great deal of freedom, he says. What's wrong? Slaves are happy in Saudi Arabia. They should be happy. The only thing, he said, that they are deprived of is the right to own themselves. This is the law of Sharia. Saudi Arabia practiced slavery officially until 1962, and they are now calling back for the return of legalizing slavery today. Slavery is still practiced in the Muslim world unofficially. The lower classes are treated worse than slaves in Egypt. They are imprisoned, made to work all day. No mercy. The police can't even defend them. So you don't have to call them slaves in order to treat them worse than slaves. Saudi Arabia treats the lower class immigrants very bad. Muslims, very bad. So let me tell you, this is a tyranny. The tyranny of Sharia and the tyranny of Islamic apartheid, ladies and gentlemen. And it's time to set the record straight and take back control of historical and religious and political truths in the Middle East. We have to expose Islamic apartheid. Human rights are not more sacred and more divine than any scripture. They are not negotiable. And you won't silence me. You won't stop me from speaking on college campuses, even in the name of God. Thank you.